I'm going to open the public hearing on House Bill 640 and recognize the prime sponsor, Representative Cushing. Good morning, Representative.
Good morning, Senate members of the committee. The record, I'm Representative Randy Cushing from Hampton, Washington, District 21. And I'm here in support of House Bill 640. This is a topic that this committee is familiar with, as is the rest of the legislature. Of interest is one of the co-sponsors of this bill, to which would decriminalize possession of an ounce or less of marijuana. Representative Chuck Grassley was the prime sponsor in 1976 of a bill to decriminalize possession of 1 ounce or less of marijuana. I'm here in support of this bill. The bill, as it came before the Justice Committee, passed but for two votes. The House passed with 318-36. This particular iteration of the decriminalization bill is the product of not just the cumulative experience and discussions that have taken place over the past 40 years, but over last summer there was a consultative process that involved proponents of reform, and including and also New Futures, to try to recognize that a criminal approach, a criminalization approach to use of marijuana, in many respects, was responsible for a lot of collateral damage. We know that the state, I know, spends about $6.5 million, I believe, in prosecuting marijuana cases. And many of us believe that those funds would be better used dealing with significant drug problems or opioid addictions. This provides for this bill has a series of escalating fines for first possession, second possession, third possession. It will treat the possession of marijuana as a violation similar to a traffic ticket. I know that things have changed since the last time the legislature considered this, in that both the states of Massachusetts and Maine have legalized the possession of marijuana for recreational purposes for an adult. I live in the town of Hampton. If I go 5 miles south, I'm at the Massachusetts border where adults can use marijuana. If I go 10 miles north, I'm in Kittery, Maine, where adults can use and possess marijuana. I know that the trend nationwide is to legalization. I think that New Hampshire should at least get to a position where it does not make criminals out of people who possess a small amount of marijuana. I would hope that this committee would support this bill. I know that there are others who speak about it after me, but if you have any questions after that, please try to respond.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Representative. Are there any questions from the committee? Senator Gannon.
I have two questions. Just one, from what I find talking to all my police chiefs, they're telling me an ounce is about 48 joints. Why would you think such a quantity? For the first time we've built, just coming out of the gate when we've said no, no, no for decade after decade, why wouldn't you start with a lesser amount, like 8 joints, an eighth of an ounce, a quarter of an ounce? Why would you come so high coming out of the gate?
Well, respectfully, I don't think it's that high. I think it's consistent with the other New England states where they decriminalized. Just the decriminalization in Maine, I believe, up to, before it legalized, decriminalization up to possession of 2.5 ounces. I don't know, to be honest, how many joints of marijuana cigarettes there are in an ounce, but the idea is that, it's recognized that, there would be essentially just a personal use amount that someone would go and obtain marijuana, I believe, an ounce. I've been told it holds on, someone who uses it, it's a month's supply, but it seemed like an ounce seems like a reasonable figure. And again, it's not like it's totally new. 40 years ago, the New Hampshire House passed a bill decriminalizing an ounce of marijuana, so it's not breaking new ground. The House, in the past couple of years, the House, I think, seven or eight times has passed decriminalization of possession of an ounce of marijuana.
Follow-up?
Yeah, just one follow-up. I might have had a newer draft than this in front of us today. Can you just tell me about, is there a judge's discretion, maybe in a much newer version that's going to get presented later, on the second and third offenses, does it go to a misdemeanor? That's what I saw on a
No, it doesn't. And it goes away after there's a period of time. If you're arrested and you've been a violation, and then 10 years you've been another violation.
Okay, so it'll never go to a misdemeanor after any amount of this. Thank you very much.
Are there any further questions? I have a question. In reading the bill, I noticed that there's no reporting requirement. I would think that the legislature would want to gather statistics on the number of tickets and fines and to see over time if there is an uptick in marijuana usage and to divide it out by age group. Would you be amenable to having some sort of reporting requirement for that?
I have no objection to it. The mechanisms by which I don't know, but what now that information isn't available to the court system, but I'm not going to speak for the court system.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much. Again, further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. The chair will be Senator Bradley.
Morning, Chair, members of the committee. I am asking the committee to consider amendment 1320, which I've drafted, and I think everybody should have. Let me just walk through some of the large changes, or changes. I'll leave it up to you to determine whether they're large or not. And then why. As the sponsor indicated, I think some of the questions from Senator Gannon and yourself, Senator Carson, there was a question as to the amount. And so this amendment reduces the amount from 1 ounce to half an ounce. And I think it goes without saying why I would suggest that if we're trying to decriminalize something and give people a second chance, it should be a somewhat smaller amount, in my opinion. Secondly, the fine is changed to $300 as opposed to what I believe is $100 in the bill. If there's a desire for people to especially younger people, to go into some kind of diversion programs, $100 fine is just too easy to pay and not get some kind of opportunity for diversion. Let me just highlight a couple of other issues that I think are issues in the House passed version. More technical issues, but I think your testimony from the police chiefs as to why those technical issues are somewhat problematic. The so-called marijuana infused products, my understanding of the House passed version is that any amount of marijuana infused products, any amount, would be committing only a violation level offense. That seems to be a little wide open. Second technical issue, that juveniles would be under a House passed version an adult court as opposed to a juvenile court. I think that's a bit of an issue too. The House passed version prohibits a law enforcement officer from taking someone into custody, even if there's even if it's warranted, even children could not be taken into custody. And there's really no way for law enforcement to know if it's a first offense, second offense, or potentially more, because records like that are not available at roadside. There's new definitions of marijuana in the House passed version that conflict with the current definition. So I would hope that, and I appreciate the fact that you scheduled this hearing so that there's timely consideration for the proponents of the House passed version. We're here today to work with the police chiefs and others to come up with something that hopefully will have broader support, something that law enforcement can accept or at least live with, even if they can't support it, just because they don't feel they can support decriminalization. Hopefully something that doesn't have the technical issues that I've outlined, and something that at the end of the day does decriminalize marijuana and give, in particular, young adults or even younger than young adults a second chance and not have the kind of problems that really ought to be solved with decriminalization. So I think this amendment is an attempt to seek a compromise. It may not be perfect, it may need more work, and I would ask the committee to try and push both sides to, you know, address some of these technical issues and have something that everybody, well, enjoys. Go back to this, but remember the union leader editorial from yesterday, another Bradley special, that everybody leaves unhappy, and that's not always a bad result. So I hope the committee will push that kind of compromise.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Senator Hennessy has a question, and then Senator Farch. And Senator Gannon.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Senator Bradley, for taking my question. I'm just curious about, you said a little bit about how you came up with 300, but I'm wondering if you can say any more about that, and primarily because I have a concern about how the numbers are different depending on who's paying them. Mm-hmm. So how did 300?
Well, 300, you were, I think, probably in the House at the time that I introduced the Decrim Amendment. I believe it was in 2015, that had a $300 fine in it. I think while we want to decriminalize, we don't want to make it so easy that the fine is so low that people don't take notice of the fact that marijuana possession is an issue. My understanding of the $100 fine that's in the House passed version is that it's significantly lower than the cost of diversion programs, which run about $200, and the cost of an ounce of marijuana, I'm told, I don't know from any firsthand experience, ranges between $200 and $400 an ounce. So the $300 fine for a second, for an offense, I'm sorry, is meant to be in line with, you know, to encourage diversion and not make it so easy to just pay the fine that everybody ignores the legality or illegality of marijuana.
Thank you.
Senator Farch?
Madam Chair, I actually have a couple of questions. Thank you, Senator. Going over this, does this fine go to diversion directly, or does it go to the courts?
If I can answer that, if I can. If you look at the Bradley Amendment, beginning on line 24, it says, all fines collected under this section shall be deposited into the Alcohol Abuse Prevention and Treatment Fund.
Good, I missed that.
All right, thank you, I missed that. Thank you for, I hadn't highlighted it.
This appears to change loss of license for anyone convicted under paragraph one. That's how I'm reading it. Is that right?
That could be right.
Okay, thank you.
Senator Gannon.
Thank you, Senator Bradley. Just a really easy question. Am I reading it correctly in saying that this no longer includes the judge's discretion on a second offense? I think line 18, 19, and 20. Am I reading it right that it'll be a violation? It's a misdemeanor. That's correct. For the second offense. Okay. Yes. I like that. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any further questions for Senator Bradley? Seeing none, thank you very much, Senator.
Thank you.
The chair will call Senator Gannon.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'll be very brief. I'll go for a minute. I represent District 23, which is the most beautiful town in the state. Sandown, Chester, Danville, Fremont, Kingston, East Kingston, Exeter, Herewith, and Epping. I hope I didn't leave anyone out. I thought the best thing I could do was go to the police. They're our first line of defense. So I spoke or met with every one of my police chiefs in the last 2 weeks. And I approached them, tried to not be biased. I know I am. But, and I asked their opinion. I said, are you for or against Decrim? It's a simple question. I had my inks ended out so it wouldn't come in my colored opinion. And each chief, Connell, Briggs, Shoup, Gordon, Robinson, Parsons, Walsis, Twiss, and Garubi, I think that's all nine of them, we're pretty much all in agreement that they feel it's a gateway drug. They feel we're going to send a bad message. We're just lowering the bar another notch. It'll increase use. They look that the DEA says it's an addictive substance that affects the brain long term. They're like, why are we even bothering teaching our DARE programs if you're going to keep lowering this? That was the police chief from Exeter. And they all said I could quote them on anything, but that's as far as I'll go on that. Marijuana, it seems like everyone's thinking it's a harmless substance. It is the most common found drug out of fatality. So when you say there are no deaths, it's hard for me to hear that. As far as the bill, I was very happy. There was an earlier draft that had judge's discretion on a second offense. That was taken out, so I was happy with that. I still think the quantity is high. I'm a lawyer, so I'm used to giving and selling, but to me that 24 or so joints is more than you need for your personal use. I would, for the first time out this first year, if I had to concede to anything, if I have to lose, I'd much rather it start at like 8 or 10 joints, like an eighth of an ounce, or even maybe up to a quarter, but the half seems excessive to me. And that's all I have to say. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much, Senator. Are there any questions for Senator Gannon?
Thank you.
Seeing none, thank you. Okay, the chair will call Marianne Dempsey.
Good morning again, members of the committee. Marianne Dempsey on behalf of the judicial branch. The judicial branch does not take a position on the bill itself. I just wanted to point out two issues that have come to our attention. One is in the original, and then one is in the amendment that Senator Bradley spoke of. In the original bill, possession by a minor would be a violation, and that would be taken out of the juvenile court system because it would not be a misdemeanor, it would be a violation. RSA 169B32 lists violations that are outside of the juvenile court jurisdiction. I will tell you it's out just because it doesn't meet the definition of delinquency. However, we would ask the statute be amended to include this offense just as it does possession of alcohol and other motor vehicle offenses. My understanding is the sponsors would work with us to do that. Under Senator Bradley's amendment, if I can switch gears and go to that one, that would actually keep it as a misdemeanor for juveniles. So that would be in juvenile court, and it would order a substance abuse assessment within 60 days after the adjudication. The concern or the issue that we wish to bring to the committee's attention is that juvenile matters have to be addressed in a shorter time frame than that 60-day period. In fact, the time frame between adjudication and disposition is either 21 days if the juvenile is being held or 30 days if not. So we would ask that the substance abuse assessment, if ordered, be done in a time frame that helps fit within right now the statutory requirements for when the court needs to fully dispose of a juvenile matter. So those are the two issues that I bring to the committee's attention. We're happy to work with folks on that, but we did want to note those difficulties.
Are there any questions? Senator Lansky?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you for being here. Just so I clear on this, if the change is made to the bill as introduced in the House, the first offense will not be, a court-ordered offense, correct?
That's right. Well, it wouldn't be in juvenile court. They would be treated essentially a violation. Someone under the age of 18 who's charged with possession, they would not be in juvenile court because it would not. So it would still be a violation as it would be for any other individual. They would go through the same process as every individual, but it would not be in juvenile court. I will tell you, the original bill still keeps marijuana-infused products as a misdemeanor, and so that would go into the juvenile system. But the way the original bill is written right now, it doesn't order a substance abuse assessment. So that 60-day time frame doesn't seem to be a problem as I read it right now in the original bill.
Sure, there consequently is no record or anything on that juvenile.
That's right.
Thank you.
Yep. I just want to make sure that I heard you correctly.
Sure.
I'm looking at the Bradley Amendment on page 2, line 16, where there's discussion about the substance abuse assessment to be completed with 60 days. You're telling us that that is not consistent with current practice and that it must be within 21 days if the juvenile is being held and 30 days if they're not being held.
Right.
So if we were to adopt this language, then this would need to be addressed.
That's exactly okay. It. And it's RSA 169B:16 that sets forth the time frame in which a juvenile matter has to be addressed. And that's where that 21-30 day time frame comes from. But that is.
Good as far. Okay, thank you. Senator Gannon?
Just a quick, easy question.
promise.
At the juvie level, it's all about rehabilitation, right? There is no level of punishment or thought about that, right? It's just rehabilitation. Great, thank you.
Okay. Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Sure, thank you.
Okay, the chair will call Kate Fry.
Good morning, members of the committee. My name is Kate Fry, and I'm the Vice President of Advocacy at New Futures. As many of you may know, New Futures has opposed decriminalization of marijuana bills for the past several legislative sessions. We are not taking a position on this year's bill because we're comfortable with the language in HB 640, and has addressed concerns and endorsed the prevention principles New Futures brought forward during past conversations on this type of legislation. We will continue, New Futures, to voice concerns regarding the negative impact of marijuana, particularly to youth, and especially in terms of brain development. Today's marijuana is far more potent than in the past, and the average THC in marijuana has dramatically increased from 4 to 6% to more than 15%, as high as 95% in edible products. And lastly, the relationship between the perceived risk of harm and increased rate of drug use has been well established by public health researchers. However, through the course of several discussions this summer with New Hampshire ACLU and proponents of decriminalization, we identified common ground that is reflected in the legislation, in the language of purpose, the purpose statement in 640. The common ground includes sensible marijuana policy reform. It has the potential to reduce criminal penalties that can lead to a lifetime of harsh consequences and to address social and racial inequities in New Hampshire's criminal justice system. Attempts to decriminalize small amounts of marijuana must take place in conjunction with efforts to prevent marijuana use and promote early screening and risk assessments in the treatment of adolescents with marijuana use problems. And limiting minors' access to marijuana-infused products is important to both to protect young children from accidental ingestion and prevent marijuana use among adolescents. Once we established this common ground, we began to discuss collaboratively marijuana policy that balances both public health and equity principles. So the public health and prevention principles that we advocated for to be included in the marijuana reform legislation are below. And, or in your testimony and in the cell. Our priority when considering any policy will always be the impact and access to youth. Any legislation involving decriminalizing marijuana must have a built-in risk assessment for young offenders. I know the previous speaker said there wasn't a risk assessment. There is in this in the original language. Laws must include a mandatory risk assessment and connections to treatment. Proposed legislation should have a prevention component to it. Must have a sustainable funding source, so fines from these violations should support informed education programs, and this legislation does that as well. Due to concerns of the increase in potency in marijuana-infused products and the increase in accidental poisonings in other states, decriminalization legislation must have provisions or plans in place on how to deal with marijuana-infused products and edibles, and this legislation attempts to do so as well. And also, in order to support the concept of equity and decriminalization policy, penalties associated with marijuana possession should reflect equitable treatment and not be overly excessive. We're pleased to see the principles have been included in HB 640. We are grateful to the stakeholders for including these prevention values within the legislation. I should note if the legislation were to be amended away that would deviate from any of these prevention principles, we would have to oppose in the future. I know there has been discussion about an amendment. We did review the amendment. We would continue to look at any amendment very closely to ensure that there are prevention principles within that legislation.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions in the committee? I just have a question. Are marijuana-infused products, are they all labeled?
If they're within the therapeutic cannabis program, they should be labeled. If they're sold legally from out of state, they should be labeled as well.
Does that label include the marijuana content of the product?
My understanding is that it does.
So that if, I'm just going to ask some questions here. So that if you have a juvenile who decided they're going to Maine and they're going to buy these types of products and they bring them back into the state and they get stopped by the police will be able to look at them and look at the content because it'll be clearly labeled.
Yes, but also, you know, it's still a misdemeanor if a youth does have that type of product.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, the chair will call Representative Sepharetta.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's, I haven't been here in about 14 years since I served on this committee, so it's good to be back. We looked at this also. I have to remind you, I'm the Vice Chairman, also Frank Sapporetto, representing Gary, Vice Chairman of the Criminal Justice Committee, and we heard this testimony in Hall of Reps all day long from all the groups, and we had no opposition to this bill. I would bring up one issue that Senator, as a former member of Ways and Means for four terms, we had looked at the penalty assessments of $1 fines. Those, the penalty assessments when you add to them make the fine substantial if you've got penalty assessments. To the point where, for example, in my town, it's designed to it actually supports the court costs, pays the fees, and it's turned into a little business. I'll use a personal example of this that happened to my son that had was at Pinkerton, and he had a brownie, one one-thousandth of a gram of marijuana in it. I mean, it's negligible. Not too, but turned into. They tried to, he's a grade A student, never been in trouble in his life, always studious. They tried to put him away for 10 years of felony through Brentwood. They spent tens of thousands of dollars trying to prosecute him to ruin his entire life. He got it removed afterwards. He never graduated with honors from his college right now. If they had had their way now, he'd probably be sweeping floors right now. That's the problem with the law. It's ruining what's happening to our youth. And here's the main thing. Since I served on this committee, in the Senate committee, I've done ride-alongs now with the police, and I urge all of you to do that. It may really change your opinion about how this bill is passed. And all the ride-alongs I've done in the southern tier of New Hampshire, as many of you know, Troop B has only about 7 or 8 troopers. They service the towns with under 3,000 people. Every stop that we made, that we had someone get out of the car, age 18 to 63, had a roach, a grinder, or some type of paraphernalia, the policeman would ask them, do you have anything else in the car that would catch it? And they'd say, yes, I've got a roach in the ashtray, I've got a grinder. Now the officer turned to me and says, should I make an arrest? If he does make the arrest, as you know, 6 or 7 of them, there'd be no law enforcement in the southern tier of New Hampshire Monday through Fridays. And in all those communities in the southern tier of New Hampshire, because all they would be doing is be driving from 93 back to Milford and back with arrests. Now this is before Massachusetts even legalized marijuana, or Maine. We're not. If you really want to do this right and you're going to put these on them, you need to spend another 15 to 20 million to put the troop officers you need in that southern tier to enforce the law. Otherwise, it's a joke. And here's the problem. When we let the person go, if that person gets in an accident, who gets sued? That's the problem that we have right now. And if you do these ride-alongs, you're going to see all this for yourself. Yet when I talk to people who oppose it, no one's done a ride-along. Get out there and find out for yourself, and you'll make your own decision. And that's really what we have found. The other issue we found too is now since Maine has now legalized that, anybody bringing a product into Maine because they're landlocked in New Hampshire is now guilty of felony, life imprisonment for a truck driver carrying product into Maine. I think that violates the Privileges and Immunity Clause in the U.S. Constitution for interstate trade. And these are all the things that we found in Ways and Means when we looked at this. I chaired the subcommittee that looked into legalization for marijuana, and I was opposed to this until I saw all these things myself and went to do them myself. And I urge you all to do that as well.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you. Okay, the chair will call Matt Simon.
Thank you, Madam Chair. For the record, Matt Simon. I live in Manchester. I work for the Marijuana Policy Project, a national nonprofit. This is my 10th year advocating for marijuana decriminalization in New Hampshire. So I'm not going to repeat all the things I've said in this committee over the years. I've only given you 3 pieces of paper today. Seems that, first of all, as you heard from Representative Saporetto, there was no testimony against this bill in the House. But since it has come to the Senate, it has become a very different conversation in the last couple of weeks as amendments have been circulated, and it seems that many senators aren't that interested in seeing the House's version. But you have it in front of you, and I hope that is what you're looking at first and foremost, is to understand why 90% of the House voted to do this. Why the House has 8 times in the last 10 years sent bills like this to this committee. The opposition that we're hearing now, I think today, will be from the police chiefs. Chief Crate has been testifying against this bill for 9 years. The top handout includes a quote from him in 2010 where he said that 99% of police officers in New Hampshire oppose decriminalization. Not even 1% support it. If this legislation is passed, we will see a wave of devastation not seen before in our wonderful state. So based on comments like that, I can understand why legislators might believe that, quote unquote, law enforcement is opposed to reducing marijuana penalties, because it sounds like the Chiefs of Police Association is speaking on behalf of everybody in law enforcement. That has never been true. It wasn't true in 2010. It isn't true today. In 2014, one of the best known police chiefs in the state ran for state senate. He put out a public statement supporting decriminalization. That's included in this handout. He pointed out that Maine decriminalized 40 years ago, an ounce and a quarter of marijuana, and it works there, and it can work here. This is his quote. I worked with legislators in Vermont in 2013. They passed a decriminalization bill very similar to the one the House approved. In the first year, there was an 80% reduction in marijuana arrests. We had the same type of testimony against it. Certainly the Chiefs of Police Association, there were at least a dozen police chiefs in uniform with badges lobbying against this bill in Vermont, saying things much like Chief Prater said over the years. And now that Vermont has moved beyond that conversation and has had that law in the books for 40 years, the police chiefs don't have any objection to it. And in fact, they often comment that they're spending way less time dealing with minor marijuana possession arrests instead of having to arrest somebody, process them, book them, and then show up in court and take up a court's time for a small amount of marijuana. They're able to write the person a ticket, confiscate the marijuana, and go do something that the public supports them doing. Something that will protect, hopefully, public safety and make New Hampshire a safer state. So Chief George Merkel from Virginia, Vermont, was shocked when we were even considering decriminalization in 2013. And all year this year, he's been saying, I think the decrim bill's fine, it works fine. We're not spending time arresting people. We're not going out of our way looking for marijuana. We're inundated with opioids. We spend all of our time dealing with opioids, meth, heroin, and things like that. So I would challenge you, if you really believe this is going to cause negative consequences in New Hampshire, please talk to people in the neighboring states. They've done this. They've had it. For Vermont's the most recent one in 2013. Maine's had it for over 40 years. Mm-hmm. Can you find law enforcement people in those states and policymakers in those states who regret decriminalization, who wish we could go back? I don't think so. We don't hear from them. The lawmakers in those states that I know don't hear from them. So the second page is just a one-pager of the American Academy of Pediatrics. If reducing marijuana penalties was going to result in increased youth use or other problems for youth, I seriously doubt the American Academy of Pediatrics would strongly endorse decriminalization, but they do. And they cite research that looks at all the states that make cannabis legal for medical use or for decriminalized, and they accurately note that it has not led to an increase in youth use rates, period. And it hasn't. The third handout is all of the data from the states that have gone the next step and legalized for adult use, and I often hear that that's led to skyrocketing rates, and I'm really curious to know what data people are looking at to make those types of assumptions. Reality is marijuana is widely available, it's widely used. People feel like they have a right to put what they want in their own bodies, and particularly substance that we know is objectively less harmful than alcohol, objectively less harmful than the drug we sell on the side of our roads in New Hampshire. So this bill is not about giving people a second chance. That might have been what a compromised version a few years ago would have been about. But this bill is about a compromise today. There have been four statewide polls in a row showing that 60% or more of grantstaters believe a $100 fine is $100 too high. They think marijuana should be legal for adult use. Four polls in a row. Decrim, two polls in a row, 72% support. So all of the specific questions about how to make this a better policy, I'm open to those, and we would certainly be happy to comment and work to make this the best policy it can be for New Hampshire. But to make it a policy where police can still arrest anybody if they want to at their discretion, to make it so that the second offense is still a criminal offense, those aren't decriminalization policies. And if that's what ends up passing, I think we have to ask ourselves a really fundamental question. Is this a government of, for, and by the people? Or is it a government of, for, and by the police? And I'll conclude with that, and I'll be happy to take the question.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Any questions? Senator Hennessy.
Thank you very much, and thanks for taking my question. I apologize for having to run out to introduce another bill. I'm really curious, and I don't know if you can answer this, but I'm really curious about what we're seeing is data that can support either side. And I'm curious about if you have any opinions about why that is, or, yes?
I do.
Okay.
I have a strong opinion about that. There's been, for over 7 years in the United States, a concerted propaganda campaign to demonize marijuana. It is a Schedule I controlled substance. We have an Office of National Drug Control Policy, which is the federal, they're supposed to be educating all of us about drugs. And it's actually part of their authorization language. The law that authorizes the ONDCP to exist includes a requirement that they oppose any effort to legalize a substance listed in Schedule I. So I'm very well aware of the Rocky Mountain High Intensity Drug Trafficking Area Report. It's great for starting fires, but it's not research. It's combustible. It'll help you get a good fire going in your living room. But it is cherry-picked data presented in a deliberately misleading fashion. And as somebody who was a college instructor for 7 years and taught students how to do research, how to think critically about what they're reading, how to present data in a coherent and objective fashion and make an argument based on that data, Rocky Mountain High is not that. It's propaganda. The lawmakers in Vermont who have spent weeks on this have heard phone testimony from the authors of those reports. They've heard testimony from the state regulators that completely contradicts Rocky Mountain High. And they've ultimately most, I think, determined that that's not something they should be basing their data on. Some of the data in those reports is accurate. Others is not, and it's presented in a very misleading fashion. If you just read the executive summary of those reports, you would think the sky was falling.
Thank you.
Okay, is there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony this morning. The chair will call Richard Craig.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Richard Craig. I'm the chief of police in Enfield, and I'm here today to represent the New Hampshire Association of Chiefs of Police in opposition of House Bill 640 as written. We have long testified against bills that would make drugs easier to acquire due to the harm it brings to people in our communities. We work hard every day, we see in our work every day the negative effects that drugs, and yes, even marijuana, has on our citizens. There are a number of problems with House Bill 640 that Senator Bradley brought this up. First of all, it's very confusing. And there are a lot of unforeseen consequences. 1 ounce, and you'll see in the facts that I gave you, shows a picture of a quarter ounce, a half ounce, and 1 ounce. Now that's a photograph, so please just try to look at that in the sense of the 3D version as well that was in front of you. Anyone 21 years of age or older possessing any amount of out-of-state regulated marijuana-infused products would be committing a violation-level offense. That means somebody could go down to Massachusetts and load up their car with marijuana-infused products, and they'd only be committing a violation-level offense of a $100 fine. This is the part that really bothers me about the current written bill. Juveniles will be summoned to court in our adult court systems. Imagine a 13 or 14 year old standing up in a crowded courtroom to face the consequences of this violation. Having been a prosecutor and been in court a number of times, even when I go and I testify, I get nervous in court, let alone, you know, watching the defendant standing there, whether they're represented, whether they have their parents, or anybody. That's just wrong to have children in our adult court systems. It's my understanding that that was put in there to not legalize it for juveniles, because under our, if it was a violation level offense, then children can't be brought in. It's a CHINS petition, which means that it's only a course of conduct similar to running away or truancy where they would be brought into court. And because it's not a misdemeanor level offense, they can't be brought before the juvenile justice system. I don't agree with it with our tobacco violations that kids go into court. I definitely don't agree with it here. It's just the wrong step. Just a year or two ago, you changed the age of majority from 17 to 18, and now we're going to put kids in adult court. It's just wrong. If a child fails to appear under the current version, then the judge would be issuing a bench warrant for that child's arrest. Again, that's ridiculous. The bill also prohibits police from taking anyone into custody. Someone could provide a false name, and we have no way of verifying that. Now, I'm working with the courts on bail reform to look at, you know, how we're working on our bail and who gets bailed under what conditions. And we're developing a risk assessment instrument that will make this better for everybody. So it's not going to tie up police officers taking people into custody on every case. And already departments are not doing that. They're releasing people on summonses. But in this, prohibiting us from doing that, there's no other statute written that I know of that prohibits a law enforcement officer from taking somebody into custody. None. Also, the fine is low, and it's going to be cheaper for somebody to pay their fine than it is to go to diversion. Our diversion programs are $200 to $300. And yes, some of them, many of them have a sliding scale based on, you know, what the family can afford. But again, a $100 fine is just too low. Due to the many problems associated with this bill, we feel that it's going to result in, you know, legalization in a sense. Senator Bradley's amendment, which we have worked on, we believe satisfies the intent of decriminalization. It reduces the penalties for possessing small amounts of marijuana and preventing use among adolescents without legalization. The decriminalization of marijuana is a major expansion of drugs at a critical time in our state. I don't think anybody will disagree, maybe Mr. Simon will, but that marijuana is harmful and unhealthy. And we need to make sure that that message is still out there, that we don't want our kids, we don't want anybody using marijuana. It's not something that's healthy. It's not like drinking orange juice. I will say also that the $300 fine that's on there is consistent with our alcohol fine, which is also $300 for possessing. And the loss of license if somebody is transporting marijuana under the motor vehicle statute is what's already written in the statute already. So it doesn't enhance that or change that. Again, thank you for your time and listen to my testimony.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Chief. Are there any questions? Senator Hennessy?
Thank you for taking my question, Chief. Great. And what I'm wondering is, you mentioned that the $300 is the same as the alcohol fine. Are other things in Senator Bradley's amendment also similar to alcohol fines and whether it's a misdemeanor or a...
Well, alcohol is a violation already.
Okay.
So it's consistent with that, just obviously not the amount. And kid is found with a lot of alcohol, that's, you know, we don't weigh it.
Right, right.
Follow up?
Please.
Yes, follow up.
So what about things like the prohibiting from taking into custody, juvenile court, and those things? Are those different from alcohol related?
The current version, absolutely. And it's not so much written into the statute that we have to take somebody into custody. There's a Supreme Court case that came out of Kingston, New Hampshire, Welby versus Kingston. It was, I believe, decided in 1987. And back then, Massachusetts drinking age was 18. So if you're 18, you could go to Massachusetts and buy alcohol legally. Some kids did that. They were picked up by the Kingston Police Department. The Kingston Police Department did what law enforcement in many parts of the state did back then. They dumped the alcohol out on the kids, and they then dumped it out and sent them on their way. Unfortunately, these kids were persistent. Went back to Massachusetts, got more alcohol, and a few hours later, I think three out of four were killed in a vehicle accident. one of the parents sued the Kingston Police Department because they did not follow their duty, because they should have taken these kids into custody. They should have released them to their parents, towed their car, and had they done that, those children would still be alive today. So in that situation, we would have, you know, we, law enforcement, take kids into custody and bring them home to their parents. Not to, you know, not to arrest them, handcuff them, and bring them to jail or anything else like that, but to bring them so that they're safe and bring them home to their parents. Because we do know that the kids are not going to make the best decisions all the time. In the current version, we'd be prohibited from doing that. And I can tell you right now, I'd be violating the current version because I would not be releasing a child just on their own with a ticket after I pick them up with drugs. I, as a parent, would not want that at all. I think there's a higher responsibility as a citizen than there is to my job as a policeman to bring those kids home safe to their parents.
Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony, Chief. The chair will call Devin Chaffee.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and other honorable members of the committee, and thank you so much for the opportunity to testify before you this morning on what is a very important issue and certainly a priority for the ACLU of New Hampshire. For the record, my name is Devin Chaffee, and I am the Executive Director of the ACLU of New Hampshire, and I'm here to testify in support of HB 640. HB 640, as you've heard, has been the result of a lengthy process of negotiation and discussion amongst many stakeholders. But I sort of want to start because I think that the focus of this hearing has shifted with the introduction of Senator Bradley's amendment. And I have great respect for Senator Bradley. We've worked with Senator Bradley on a number of very important criminal justice reform issues. And of course, I can understand the desire to bring all stakeholders together to an agreement that all stakeholders find reasonable and rational. And I also want to say that I have great respect for New Hampshire's police chiefs as well. I respect the work that Chief Crate is doing on bail reform. Have worked with Chief Goldstein and others, and Chief Droulet, the current heads of the Chiefs Association, on the body camera bill. I've worked with them in the past. But I want to suggest that the amendment that has been brought forth by Senator Bradley today is not, in fact, a compromise. A compromise, from my perspective, involves bringing stakeholders together, starting with principals like in futures and other stakeholders were able to do over the summer and into the fall, and then coming to a point, you know, working through those issues and coming to a point of a product that gives a little on both sides. I believe that's the process, for instance, that we went through with the body camera bill, where we had all the stakeholders around the table, many hours of negotiation, and we were able to come out with a product that we were quite proud of. I don't believe that the amendment that has been put forth today is a compromise, because I believe it's an amendment that has been primarily, the foundation for this amendment is coming from the chiefs of police, because the chiefs of police want to continue to arrest people for marijuana violations of possessions of small amounts of marijuana. And I understand why they want that authority. Of course, they're out there, you know, they want the authority to, you know, the maximum authority that they can for law enforcement in their communities. It's certainly not irrational, but the bottom line is that's not what decriminalization is about, and that's not what the people of New Hampshire want when they say in poll after poll, year after year after year, that the vast majority of people in New Hampshire support decriminalization. When we say decriminalization, what that means is getting law enforcement out of the business of spending taxpayer resources on these small marijuana possession offenses. And that means moving from a situation where you are arresting these folks, whether it's as a violation for the first offense and then the misdemeanor in the second, and subsequent offenses as is outlined in the amendment that's been proposed today, you know, that's not what decriminalization is about. It's about getting away from that and getting towards the model that's set forth in 640, which is allows people, you have a fine, it's like a traffic ticket, you take the fine and you mail it in, and it's not creating burdens on law enforcement, it's not expending excessive resources, and it's also not creating massive disruption in the lives of the people who are in violation. I want to talk a little bit about why do we want to do this, and it's because there are significant costs to New Hampshire's current policy. That's why we have seen a trend towards decriminalizing small amounts of marijuana in states throughout this country and in every other state in New Hampshire. And these costs are both financial, and these costs are very human as well. And those are the two things that I really want to address today. And I know you've seen this infographic from me before, certainly the current members, but there are some new members of the committee that I want to be able to show this to. So ACLU did a study state by state of the costs associated with marijuana possession charges enforcements. And in the state of New Hampshire, in a single year, New Hampshire spent $6.5 million enforcing these low-level, small possession possession of marijuana charges. And these are just marijuana possession charges. And so there is a real cost there. I would also note, as you'll see in that infographic, that these enforcement fall disproportionately on persons of color in the state of New Hampshire. In fact, if you're black, you're 2.6 times more likely to be arrested for marijuana possession charges than if you're white. And in fact, this is even though there is really no disparity in use. And so these arrests do happen in the state of New Hampshire. And I understand that Chief Crate's department under his leadership may not be making these arrests in the way that other departments are, but they are happening, and they're happening to real people. And I think in the room here today, we probably have several people who either themselves or their relatives or a child of a relative that they know whose life has really been upended because of one of these arrests for small amounts of marijuana. And I want to highlight on a few cases that rose, and most of these aren't high profile. Most of these people who get evicted or face other collateral consequences for these types of arrests don't make the papers. But there have been a few in recent times that have, and I want to highlight those for you. The first case is a couple, a former Navy veteran with MS, Brian Cardinal, and his partner, Lorraine Sydney, who suffered a traumatic brain injury from a car accident, and they were evicted from their apartment in Lebanon after being charged with possession of a small amount of marijuana, which they were using for therapeutic purposes, although they were not eligible for New Hampshire's therapeutic cannabis program. And so they were essentially evicted from their house. There were court fines and fees of over $1,000 that they were forced to bear. And all told, if you look, you know, I've been told by attorneys involved in this case, if you look at the attorney's time, the defense attorneys, the prosecutors, the police reports that were filed, you're talking about tens of thousands of dollars that were spent to penalize this couple who clearly did not have a lot of capacity for this small marijuana possession charge. And you saw a lot of outrage in the press about this, and I think it's very understandable why. And so this is the couple you see in this picture, and it's a Valley News article about their experience.
Ms. Tempe, I just want to get some clarification on that article. Isn't it true that that couple lived in federally subsidized housing?
So my understanding is that yes, that it may have been due to the way that the housing was subsidized, but the reason why the police pursued the matter as they did, instead of say through the system that was set up through HB 640, is because possession of small amounts of marijuana are currently criminalized. So the essence of the question that you're asking is, would that situation have turned out the same under a decriminalization regime?
No, that's not the question I'm asking. I'm asking about clarification, and at this point I'm not going to get into an argument about you, because this is basically a state versus a federal issue. If they live in federally subsidized housing, the federal government has different standards about what can happen within an apartment or any type of housing that they subsidize We have no control over that. That is something that has been outlaid by the federal government. And so I just want to make it clear to everybody, and I'm familiar with this case because as many people, I read this, and I don't believe that decriminalization would have had any effect on this issue whatsoever because they were living in federally subsidized housing, which has very strong and very well-stated rules about drug use in federally subsidized housing.
Thank you, Senator Person. And I do, and your point is certainly taken that the federal government has its rules with regards to housing and other rules as well. I know that there is an attorney who will testify after me who can probably provide some more of those details because certainly while those rules are set by the federal government, the conduct of the local law enforcement that were engaged in that incident are actually their authority in these matters is set by the state of New Hampshire. And so, you know, obviously there are points at which those two intersect, and I will allow the attorney who was more engaged in that particular case to discuss that more thoroughly, if that's okay.
Yep.
The other case that I want to bring your attention to is that of Jeffrey Pendleton, who was actually a former client of the ACLU of New Hampshire, not in this particular matter, but in a previous matter that we successfully appealed for Mr. Pendleton, who was essentially homeless at the time. Mr. Pendleton was arrested on a minor marijuana possession charge. He was jailed at Valley Street, and he died days later from an overdose of fentanyl that he presumably got while he was in jail. And to be honest, one has to wonder if he would even have had access to the fentanyl if he hadn't been incarcerated. And so just another example of the potential human impact of arrest for these small possession of small amounts of marijuana. Now, I do want to get to and actually address the language in HB 640, which is the bill that passed the House, again, highlighting that it passed the Criminal Justice Committee in the House 14-2, and it passed on the House floor 318-36, which is by far the largest margins that it has ever passed the House. And I think the reason why that is because of the work that we did with New Futures as the stakeholders to give serious thought and consideration and to address their issues with regarding prevention of teen use and also allowing for significant assessments for individuals that need treatment to be able to get that treatment. And so I want to address some of the technical issues that Senator Bradley brought up. First, I want to talk a little bit about the way that the bill addresses edibles and the reason why that is, and some potential technical amendments that could be made to the bill that would help strengthen that part of the bill and make it more restrictive even than it currently is. The way that the bill is written is primarily because, and it gets to Senator Carson's earlier point earlier on in this hearing, we know that the fact of the matter is, whether we like it or not, Maine and Massachusetts have now legalized marijuana and will be selling it and taxing it for recreational use. And so what we didn't want to do is create a decriminalization regime that had the practical impact of discouraging people. Both of these regimes are going to require that edibles be sold in childproof containers that are clearly marked. We don't want to be in a situation where we're creating incentives for people to go into a dispensary in Maine, buy some edible products, take them out of that container and put them into a Tupperware non-childproof container, because then if they are pulled over by the police will have no way of knowing that these are in fact THC infused products. We didn't want to create that incentive, and that is something that we discussed at length with New Futures, because that could potentially put children further at risk. And so the way that the HB 640 addresses this issue is it says, if you are coming from these dispensaries and you have acquired those edibles legally, then that is decriminalized for individuals of 21 age and older. Again, because we wanted to address this issue of potential teen use and the belief that teens are more likely to be engaged in use of edibles than others. That's why the age is also greater there. What the original bill, and this I think is a drafting issue, it certainly wasn't, I don't believe, the sponsor's intention, is it didn't put a very clear limit on the THC content. And again, as Senator Carson was asking Ms. Fry, it does, that THC content is labeled on edibles that would be coming in from, say, a dispensary in Maine or in Massachusetts. And so I want to suggest an amendment that I think would be make sense and be helpful, that would, in fact, limit the amount of THC-infused products to only 300 milligrams of THC, which we believe is an appropriate amount that you would see coming out of the dispensary. And then by having this system set up, what HB, again, 640 does is it creates an incentive for people to keep those edibles in a childproof container, and so that they are less likely, that young people are less likely to get access to those. And so I will distribute this this amendment, and I'm happy to answer any questions associated with it. I'm sorry. Very quickly, I just want to quickly address some of the other issues that Senator Bradley brought up. First, I would say that on the issue of juveniles, the way that the bill addresses juveniles, again, as Chief Crate mentioned, is very similar to how juveniles with alcohol violations are currently treated under the system. This came from a discussion that involved prosecutors, and it involved the public defender's office, and it involved many different stakeholders. I think that certainly, at least from our perspective, we would be open to considering having those issues involving juveniles to remain in juvenile court. It's not something that we're fundamentally opposed to at all, and would certainly be willing to consider that. I'm sorry, I've addressed the infused product amount. I'm sorry, I'm just trying to look at the other issues that Senator Bradley brought up. And I would just say that the other issue, and I think that is really at the heart of this the tension between the Senator Bradley's amendments and HB 640 as passed by the House, is this desire, quite frankly, to continue to arrest people and bring them into jail for possession of small amounts of marijuana on that part of the police chiefs. I don't see Senator Bradley's amendment as a compromise. I don't believe that it involved the House sponsors of the bill or the other critical stakeholders were engaged in the drafting of that amendment. And at least from my perspective, really, a vote for the amendments that have been proposed here today is really a vote against decriminalization and a vote for police continuing to arrest people for possession of small amounts of marijuana. So I would respectfully very much urge this committee, there are certainly tweaks that could be made. We're more than happy to work with the committee, but I would respectfully urge the committee to start with HB 640 as your start. That is the more solid of the bill that actually accomplishes what we're trying to accomplish when we talk about decriminalization of possession of small amounts of marijuana. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much for your testimony, Ms. Chaney. Are there any questions? Senator
Rowski? Thank you, Madam President. Good morning. Thank you for being here. You've seen the amendment that has been passed out from last in Hennessy and Prince. Does that address the concerns that you were just alluding to?
Yeah, so what it does is it puts a very clear limit on the amount of infused products that can be brought in as legally purchased in a state where the recreational use has been used. And that's the only type of edible that has been decriminalized under this bill. If you make your own edibles or you have your own edibles infused product made within the state, that's not actually decriminalized under this bill. And that's a compromise. That's part of compromise, right? From the ACLU's perspective, would we like to have seen more edibles included? Probably. But in our discussions with New Futures, we thought what is really key is we just don't want to create bad incentives by keeping criminalized edibles that could be safely contained in those containers. And we decided that this was a reasonable compromise and a reasonable approach.
Thank you. And it does put into the statute that a a packaging will contain no more than 300 milligrams of THC, which was, again, a fair one concern.
Exactly, and again, the amount would be indicated on the packaging, and there you also make it easier for law enforcement because they can simply look at the packaging and they hopefully will be able to tell if it's under the limit.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony. The chair will call to me.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the committee. My name is Paul Toomey. I'm from Chichester. I've been a criminal defense lawyer for a long period of time. I was also House Legal Counsel, and I took part in the stakeholders' meetings that everybody's described to you. We're over a many month period of time, different groups, including the ACLU, New Futures, Marijuana Policy Project, got together and tried to work out something that reflected a reasonable compromise and a way to take possession of small amounts of marijuana out of the criminal courts and deal with them in other ways. I was there as a volunteer. I didn't work for any of those groups, but I did help draft the statute because I have a lot of background in both drafting statutes and dealing with criminal law. I'm going to talk about the technical aspects of this in a little bit, but let me just back up, start off with a story about a human being, because ultimately this is all about human beings and the effect that the state's actions have on human beings. I was the counsel for Mr. Cardinale, which was the individual in the Lebanon case that was in the newspaper article up there. He was a disabled vet. He had service-connected disability. He'd had it for 20, 30 years. He did not want to take opiates through other vets. He was told that problems that he was having, the medical problems could be helped with marijuana. He actually did qualify for the state's program for medical marijuana, but he couldn't get on it because he got his medical care through the VA because of federal regulations. Even though he qualified under the state rules, the VA refused to sign the paper saying he had the condition. So he was basically trapped in a situation where he could have had any opiate in the world, fentanyl, any of those things. But he chose not to become addicted. He chose to try to deal with it with a medicine that this state has recognized is an appropriate medicine. And so he got small amounts of marijuana. The Lebanon police came to his house and they found about this much marijuana in his house. I believe it was 1 gram or 2 grams of marijuana, very small amount. They arrested him pursuant to the current statute. They also voluntarily chose to notify his landlord and suggest that since the landlord had received federal funds that they begin eviction on him. So that was a action that flowed from the arrest. If the Lebanon police hadn't been there in order to effectuate an arrest, none of those things would have happened. It's still theoretically possible that somehow the fact that he was using marijuana would have come to his landlord's attention, but in this case it definitely happened because it was a criminal case. In the course of that case, there were 8 police officers who filed police reports. There were 84 pages of small type narrative police reports generated. 2 police officers had to take trips to Concord to bring the 1 gram of marijuana to the state lab. Somebody at the state lab had to take the time to actually run through 3 tests called Dukinoy-Levy tests that take about 15 to 20 minutes or something like that. But then they have to also write reports themselves over, which I didn't count in the 84 pages of police reports. During the time the lab was doing that, they couldn't work on their backlog of rape kit tests that exist at the state labs or any other important crimes that they should be, expediting through. Instead, they worked on this 1 gram of marijuana that another police officer had to drive from Lebanon to Concord, pick up the report, and bring it back to court. I represented Mr. Cardinale on a pro bono basis, but he did have a right to a state-appointed counsel, and that would have cost the state and taxpayers a certain amount of money. There was a prosecutor who was involved. He was paid the whole time, and he spent a good deal of time on this case. And I have no objection to anything he did. I thought he made some rational, appropriate decisions in the case. Because of the fact that they were being evicted from their housing that they've lived in for 20 years over the small amount of marijuana, I asked somebody for legal assistance if they could help with that, and they did, and they spent hours and hours and hours negotiating with the landlord and with federal officials. We ended up coming to a resolution in the case that allowed them to stay in the house. But I can tell you, if everybody was charged with full fare, society, in some ways society pays for all this stuff, society would pay about $15,000, $20,000 for this 1 gram of marijuana for a man who all he wanted to do was not be strung out on opiates. Mr. Cardinale, by the way, had no criminal record whatsoever. So this is what happens in the real world. Little people that are doing things just to try to avoid being strung out of pain, end up with criminal records, end up in a nightmare. That's the real cost of it. What this bill does, and in the course of this, as I said, we had countless meetings over the summer. The police chiefs could have come to any one of those meetings. They could have brought their concerns to the House hearings. They didn't even show up for the House hearings on this bill. Some of the things they brought up with, we could easily agree with, and we would have addressed if they just brought them to our attention at an earlier point. One is the 300 milligrams of edibles. Originally, we had that in the bill, but it referred to all edibles and all. Through the course of discussions with new preachers, we all came to the conclusion that it made sense to restrict it to edibles that were bought legally in another state, because as Senator Carson said, they have the amounts on them, they come in child-proof containers. So we put in that provision, and inadvertently, this is completely my fault, we dropped the 300 milligrams. It was meant to be in there in the first place. I thank the chiefs for catching that, and I do think it's an important thing to catch, but I think the amendment reflects that. This way, there's no incentive. If you just don't do anything to encourage people to use the ones from out of state, there's no incentive to do so, and the incentive really is, it's the second you buy them in Massachusetts, take them out of those containers, because you don't want a police officer having identified, if you've got a brownie, you just as soon have a brownie that you can say is a brownie, rather than one that comes in a package that says cannabis. So the incentive would have been to take them out immediately, and as Devin Chaffee said, put them in a some other container that's not marked and not childproof. We didn't want to do that, that's why we put that in there. In terms of the juveniles going to be treated like alcohol and tobacco in adult court or juvenile court, again, the original bill had them in juvenile court. It was because we talked to other stakeholders, including juvenile probation officers, who asked us to make that change. If the chiefs had come in and said, no, we think it's better in juvenile court, quite frankly, I agree with them. But they didn't take part in this process. You know, it's really, I think, somewhat cynical of them to take no part in the process that they could have taken part in, and then come criticize about things that we would be happy to address any point in time during the process. In terms of whether cops on the road can access criminal records to determine whether it's a first, second, or third offense, in our bill, it doesn't matter because they're all violations, they're all non-criminal offenses, so they don't really have to access the criminal records. I will take their word, although I find it somewhat surprising, they have computers that they can access those records, but I'll take their word that they can. What that means is under Senator Bradley's bill, if you think it through, every single person is going to be arrested. They're going to be put in handcuffs, they're going to be put in the back, in a cage in the back for cruising. They're going to go to a police station and they're going to sit there for a bail bond sometimes. Meanwhile, they're going to be tying up the time with that police officer all that time. And that's because if they don't know if they can't tell if it's a first offense, second offense, or third offense, they're going to go back, take them back to the station and do that there. Under our version of the bill, and the House passed version of the bill, that just doesn't matter and that's not going to happen. The harm we want to avoid in this bill, and I think all the stakeholders wanted to avoid, was the harm of people being arrested, which is a harm too. 72% of the people in the state think that is a greater harm than possessing marijuana. And it's not 72 to 28, by the way, it's 72 to about 10, because there's about 15% that don't have any opinion on it whatsoever. In terms of impairment and not being able to take kids into custody, one, I think if we put it back into the juvenile system, as the chiefs do, and I think that is a good suggestion. I think that will resolve itself. Secondly, the Kingston case was over the failure to take into protective custody. There's still a protective custody statute there. If the law enforcement officer thinks that somebody's incapacitated, inebriated, and needs to be taken into protective custody under 179, RSA 179, they have the authority to do that, and that's what they do in cases of people that are high on something or drunk or whatever, walking down the street that are danger to themselves or another. They can use that with juveniles too. There's nothing that stops them. In fact, they do use it. So that can be resolved. In terms of an ounce versus half an ounce, you know, quite frankly, I don't understand the point. It's sold in an ounce quantity in the states around us, in 2.5 ounces, I guess, up in Maine. What is the point of saying you have to make twice as many trips to Massachusetts and twice as many trips to Maine? I don't get that point. It's still a personal amount. It's the amount that most of the states across the country have adopted, both in legalization and in decriminalization. So I just don't see the point of that. What I urge you to do is, and I think there are at least two, Senator Lasky's 300 milligram amendment. I think that's a very appropriate amendment. I think it absolutely should be on there, because otherwise, as the chief said, you could bring in any amount you wanted that wasn't intended and can be easily done with. In terms of the juvenile, keeping people in the juvenile justice system, we can do an amendment to do that, because we already had the language that way to begin with, and that can be suggested. I would urge you to give consideration to that. There are some reasons to not do that. There's a lot more resources that go into the court. The legislature's made a determination that with tobacco and alcohol, that adult court's the appropriate place. Personally, I've never agreed with that, but I presume that there's some reasons why those cases go to adult court, so you should think over if you want it in juvenile court. What you should do is come out of this process with something that isn't a sham. Senator Bradley's bill, which allows police to arrest for any amount, any age you are, whether it's a first offense or a 100th offense, has nothing to do with decriminalizing marijuana. Everybody's going to still get arrested. It really is sort of a tempting village of decriminalization. If you look at what happens in the courts in this state, the only people that end up with criminal records for possession of small amounts of marijuana are poor kids. Disproportionately, as ACLU research shows, disproportionately minority kids, but it's poor kids. It happens in two kinds of places. There's some places where they just do it all the time, because that's, you know, Lebanon's an example. They arrest everybody, okay? And they charge criminally everybody. Most of the places, though, if you go to court, and I think even true in Lebanon, if you go to court with a lawyer, you are never going to come up with a criminal conviction. If you go to court without a lawyer, you can go down to Manchester District Court and see this any day you want. You'll see kids going in there not knowing what they're doing, waiving their right to counsel, coming out with criminal records. What the American Association of Pediatrics has said is that kind of thing affects the rest of their lives. They go on a different track in terms of jobs, school, all those things. It may seem like a little thing to you, a $300 fine, but a simple drug conviction means you're not just not going to get certain jobs. You're going to have effects on your ability to apply to schools. You just don't, in a society, we don't want to create a society where people are on a track where they can never succeed, where they can never lift themselves up. And that's what criminalization of marijuana does. I mean, there's only one group of people that pay the full price of having a criminal record, and that's poor people. So I urge you to do something about that, as the vast majority of the people that have elected you have asked you to do that.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. The chair will call David Crawford.
Hello. My name is David Crawford. I live in Keene, New Hampshire. I'm here to urge y'all to pass this bill. I smoked pot first time probably around 79 or 78. Back, I remember Jimmy Carter was I remember he used to be pro-pot at one point, and he was thinking about legalizing it back then, but I'm not sure what happened, but that didn't happen, obviously. And that was, 40 years ago, or just 30-something years ago. So, and I smoked pot at that time. And it's true that it is stronger now, because I've got some at home. It's like very little, but...
That's too much information.
It's only like... and I tried it, and one puff will get me high. One puff, and I'm... I don't have a tolerance, obviously, and everybody knows with drugs that tolerance gets built up, so it doesn't take me much. And I just found out that it's not my cup of tea now. And but, you know, me saying this right now, who knows? People could bust at my door, I could get arrested. Look, there's police in the back. So that's what, I have a friend who was gonna come here today, and she didn't have a criminal record at all, and she has this chronic pain that she's had forever. She got in trouble. Somebody wanted to buy some pot because she used it for her pain, and somebody found out that she knew where to get it, and she went and got it for these people two or three times, and come to find out that those people that she was getting it for was the police department, and she was being set up at. She sold I don't know how much, a few ounces or something, and now she has a felony criminal record, and she never had any record before that, and she can't get housing. She's been homeless a lot. So that's one of the things. We've had presidents that smoked pot. Lots of people say Obama did. Bush is known to do with a lot of drugs. Maybe if they were poor, like the last fellow said, and they got caught, they wouldn't have excelled to the positions that they did. So I'll say one other quick thing. So there was a lady that spoke earlier, and she said something to the effect of minors or underage users that got busted would get a misdemeanor as opposed to like an adult that got caught. And I think that's one of the biggest things to that's a problem. I mean, young people getting those things on their record and then it hinders their whole life, as the last gentleman said. And so I urge you all to pass this, and I hope you will. And I'll take any question anybody has for me.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much.
Thank you.
The chair will call William Rodriguez.
Morning. So last night a friend and I were reading this bill and noticed that it's $350 for every violation after the third. And she wondered out loud if it might be possible to pay these violations in advance, sort of a plenary indulgence, so to speak. We're thinking the state could give volume discounts, punch tickets, pay 10 violations, get one free. For a certain price, the state can even sell a ticket which allows an unlimited number of violations and call that a license. Now this may sound silly, and a lot of regulations do, but the model is not unheard of. States have and do sell tax stamps, and that's basically what this is, right? If this passes, it's a sin tax. Now it's collected in a shoddy and inefficient manner. So instead of paying a buck per pack or a few dollars per ounce, you pay nothing most of the time and $350 occasionally. The random enforcement or reinforcement, I guess, is kind of exciting. It's like gambling, but involuntary. And to further that analogy, I want to say I do appreciate the opportunity to maybe lower my personal fluctuations so that I'll only be risking the amount of my life that it took me to earn $350 instead of maybe a few years. Got me thinking a little bit about the difference between a license fee and a fine. Like, can I do this thing? Sure, just give us the money. Can I do this other thing? No. I did that thing. Well, I told you not to, so give me some money. What happens if I do that again? That'll be another tree fitting. Seems to be some sort of theme here where no matter what I do, the state gets my money. I'm familiar with the model where you pay someone to go away, but the model kind of breaks down when you pay them and they just won't stay gone. I know you guys know about what's happening in Maine, and as far as recreational goes, it's not clear to me what the psychology is behind this interim position. That's clearly where things are heading. I can tell you that the economics of it kind of stinks, so much so that as of next month, I'm going to be relocating to Maine. The place is going to be booming, not just with growth, testing, recreational, and retail sales, but I will be back often to avail myself of the New Hampshire advantage, and when I do, it would be nice to not be arrested for possessing the plant that I just legally grew right over there. So if you guys could do anything about that, that'd be great.
Thank you very much for your testimony this morning. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you very much. The chair will call Carrie and, is it Garrett?
Aye.
Or
thank you, Madam Chair, and all other honorable members of the committee. My name is Carrie Ann Garnick. I am a resident of Hudson, New Hampshire, and I am also a recovering addict. I have been clean for over a year as of March 29th this year. Sorry, I'm a little bit nervous. I've never actually spoken at one of these, but so, from my experience, right, I can say pretty definitively that marijuana is not a harmless drug. I have experience being addicted to marijuana. With that said, statistically, states that have legalized medicinal marijuana. Now, this is just medicinal marijuana. We've already legalized medicinal marijuana in New Hampshire. Have seen something like 33% decrease in opioid deaths. And now, as a recovering addict, I have a lot of friends that are either addicted or in recovery. And as of this year, I have lost about something, I lost count, but it was like 20 friends this year from a heroin overdose. And I am looking and seeking for any possible legislation that can cut down on the amount of heroin overdoses in the state of New Hampshire. And like I said, while I believe that marijuana is not harmless, statistics show that states that legalize, decriminalize, legalize for medicinal purposes, have lower uses, usage rates of drugs like heroin, drugs like OxyContin, hydrocodone. And marijuana, while I cannot attest to the number of possible deaths related to car accidents or anything else, there have been zero recorded deaths in history as a direct overdose. Whereas in New Hampshire alone last year, because of opioids, it was over one person a day. And I think that with numbers that stark, I think that a bill to enforce a law against marijuana does not make sense. I go specifically to this bill, Section 2 VII, which states all fines imposed pursuant to this section shall be deposited into the Alcohol Abuse Prevention and Treatment Fund established in RSA 176A1 and utilized for evidence-informed substance abuse prevention programs. So because New Hampshire has such a bad opiate epidemic, right, the wait times to get into treatment centers and the treatment centers themselves are just astronomical. Like the amount I would have had to wait if I was to go to the treatment center in New Hampshire would have been over 2 weeks. And we're talking with opioid abuse, you know, my drug of choice is heroin. And when we're talking about opioid abuse, giving somebody a 2 week wait time to get into treatment is the difference between life and death. And I was lucky enough that I have parents that have the capability to send me to a state like Pennsylvania, where there are plenty of treatment centers with plenty of short wait times. I was able to get in 2 days after I applied. I was really lucky. But not everybody in New Hampshire has this capability. Many addicts in New Hampshire are homeless. Many addicts in New Hampshire are destitute. And, you know, I see all this money that is being spent on drug enforcement when the reality is drug treatment is what actually helps society become less addicted to drugs. And you know, I look at some of these countries like Portugal that decriminalized all drugs. And the statistics are just amazing. They decriminalized all drugs and saw something close to 70% decrease in usage. And you know, how does that happen, right? Because they focused all the resources that they were putting towards drug enforcement, towards treatment. And you know, I have heard a statistic that it costs about the same, slightly less actually, to keep somebody in treatment for 30 days than it does to keep somebody in prison for 30 days. So with that evidence, I feel like it would be a waste of my tax dollars to put it towards drug enforcement rather than drug treatment.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions? Senator Gannon?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just a quick question. I appreciate your coming. I know it's hard to testify in front of a whole room full of people. And you said you started out, you were an addict. Before the heroin, were you, and you said marijuana was addictive. Is that what the drug you started on?
I actually started on prescription pain medication. I started on OxyContin, but after a while it became very difficult to get, and you know, I always heard that obviously heroin is bad, don't do heroin. So I went directly to marijuana because I was like, well, this is a harmless drug. You know, I came to find out that like I couldn't stop alone and that it is not actually as harmless as I thought. With that said, through marijuana connection, because of the fact that it was illegal, right? I found new connections to find my drug of choice, which was opiates, right? And you know, it's hard to say because it's like hindsight is 20/20, right? But from my perspective, had marijuana been legal, I would have just stuck to marijuana. You know, I mean, and there's some argument to say like I wouldn't be clean today because heroin brought me to my knees, right? With that said, I don't think I would have tried heroin had it been for marijuana being legal.
Are there any further questions? Seeing none, thank you very much for your testimony. The chair will call Ian Freeman.
Good morning. I'm Ian Freeman, one of the co-chairs of the New Hampshire Liberty Party, and I can attest to part of what that last speaker had to say. I had a roommate a decade and a half ago who was addicted to opiates. He was crushing up pills, prescription pills, and injecting those. He used marijuana. He called the marijuana maintenance plan to get off of those pills, and he didn't need anybody else's help. Marijuana is a drug, so of course it's for a lot of people pleasurable to use it. People tend to be addicted to things that they find pleasurable, but as far as its physical addiction properties, it doesn't have that. I have used marijuana countless times in my life and have been able to successfully quit it for periods of as long as a year. So everybody has their own individual experience with that. It's really amazing to me that here we are in 2017 in the live free or die state, and we're still talking about flowers as though they're a problem. One of the earlier people who testified on this said that cannabis is an issue. I'm not sure what the issue is besides the fact that the state has made this a crime and has ruined people's lives over this, as you've already heard from some of the previous testimony. We're talking about a plant that grows naturally. It's called a weed for a reason. It's fairly prolific. It's easy to grow. You can throw seeds out anywhere and it'll just take root and start growing. We don't have to go over the amazing things that this plant has done for people from a medicinal purpose. We know that at this point. Thank you guys for moving forward on whatever medical things come in front of you perhaps later on. And I think that it's really important to point out here that the people of New Hampshire, as not only the polls have revealed, but also just my own personal experience has revealed, they're friendly to marijuana. There's a lot of people across the state who use it. They aren't concerned with the fact that it's illegal. The fact that marijuana is illegal has not stopped people from using it. I grew up in Florida and plenty of people smoked pot down there. I knew people who got busted for smoking pot. And you know what? They were counting the days on their probation until they could finally smoke pot again. They really didn't care about the laws. So raising the fine from $100 to $300 is not going to dissuade people. And increasing the fines later on isn't going to dissuade people from smoking pot. It's just going to get in their way. It's going to make them poorer because, as was pointed out, it's poor people who tend to be disproportionately affected by cannabis prohibition. New Hampshire is the live free or die state. We need to catch up with the times. Normally we shouldn't follow what the states around us do, but in this particular case, Massachusetts and Maine are correct. And the reason why they're correct isn't because the legislature got it through their heads, it's because the people were able to put a ballot measure up and vote on it. We don't have ballot measures here, and there's an argument that that's a good thing to some extent. But ultimately, perhaps New Hampshire should be the first state to actually end prohibition of marijuana through the legislative process. This bill, one of the few things I've ever agreed with Chief Crate about, is it's confusing. Why does it need to be multiple pages to have decriminalization? Why shouldn't we just strike from the statutes any prohibition on cannabis? I understand the concern about children, so fine, maybe some minor regulations around the edibles. I get that. That makes sense. But ultimately, children aren't in any specific level of danger here, more so than they currently are. People already have brownies that they're making in their homes. They already have marijuana around their homes. This is a very, very common drug. It's used throughout New Hampshire by a whole lot of people, and the statistics will show that pretty clearly. So yeah, I think we need to free up police time so they can focus on real crimes where we have victims like rape and murder and, you know, arson, property destruction, instead of messing with people who are not hurting anyone and arguably probably aren't even really hurting themselves. Used on a consumable basis without smoking it, used in a vaporizer, used in edible form, cannabis is an incredibly safe product. So I think that's pretty much all I have to say here. I have extensive experience in the underground with black market dealers and things like that, so I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Are there any questions from the committee? Seeing none, thank you. The chair will call the final speaker, Heather Brown.
Hello, how are all of you today?
You can sit.
Sorry.
That's okay.
My name is Heather Brown, and I'm not only here for myself, but for a bunch of other people that unfortunately couldn't be present today. I'm here to speak in favor of this bill. I think that it is high time that New Hampshire followed suit and actually, you know, had some pride in that whole first in the nation, let's be the first in the nation and start doing this. It's long overdue. I'm actually kind of really sad that we're not here speaking in terms of alcohol, since alcohol is way more harmful than what cannabis has ever been or will ever be. With the amount of deaths that we can attribute to alcohol, it's sad that alcohol is legal in such a booming business within the state of New Hampshire, while cannabis, whose death tolls total zero, is illegal and very limited for medical use. I unfortunately, because of those laws, am a criminal in the state of New Hampshire. I have been arrested for possession of cannabis. Did it change my behavior? No, it didn't, because my choice to use cannabis should be the same as my choice to smoke a cigarette or pick up a beer. I'm over the age of 21, I'm an adult, I am perfectly capable of making these decisions. And since cannabis is way more helpful to my body than what alcohol or tobacco will ever be, I choose that route instead. I have a bunch of different health reasons on why I choose cannabis, and I can tell you that it works, it helps. At one point in time in my youth, I was on over 50,000 milligrams of medication, 27 pills a day. You know, for a child, that's an absolutely ridiculous amount. Now, I don't have to take any medication whatsoever. Several years ago, during a period of my life when I wasn't using cannabis because I thought my health was at a good point, I was diagnosed with cervical cancer. During that time period, I took up smoking cannabis. From the time they diagnosed me with it, I had one spot. 6 weeks later, when they brought me in for surgery, my entire cervix and most of my uterus was completely covered in it because of how aggressive a form it was. They did what they could do. Unfortunately, because of insurance restrictions, it wasn't a whole heck of a lot. And I was sent home to be beat up and brutalized by the surgery that they had done trying to save my life. They weren't able to get it all. I consumed my use of cannabis and my use of oils, and it actually slowed the growth of the cancer. It actually, after a certain amount of time, the cancer started to go away. I am here today, I firmly believe, because of my use of cannabis. I find it ridiculous that it's illegal and that there's so many limitations for this. I realize we do have a medical program, but our medical program is so limited that there are thousands of people within the state of New Hampshire that cannot benefit. If we were to decriminalize it and even hopefully take the stance to end prohibition permanently, then those people would be able to access those benefits as well. I really I just can't express enough how it's time. And you know, everyone brings up the children and so forth, and some individuals have great concerns about the effects that cannabis is going to have if we open the doors and let it into our homes. Well, I can assure you, do your children sit at home and drink beer? No, because you've instilled in them that alcohol is not what they're supposed to touch. Do any of you yourselves, not that you have to answer, keep a bottle of alcohol in your cupboard or a liquor cabinet or beer in the fridge? And I'm, you know, if you had children, what are you going to tell your children? Do not touch that. That is not for children. Your medications that you keep put up, what do we tell our children? Do not touch that. That is not for children. You let cannabis into your home? Do not touch that. That is not for children. It is absolutely no different. In fact, I have more concerns about our children's ability to have access to prescription medications and alcohol more than I do cannabis. I think that there's a huge stereotype associated around the entire black market industry, the entire cannabis theory, everything. Cannabis is not a gateway drug, but cannabis could ultimately wind up being the drug that ends it all. It can end addiction, it can end health problems, it can take care of cancer, it can free up law enforcement to actually be able to work and focus on more severe crimes that are taking precedent within our state right now, between rape, murder, the opioid crisis that is going on. The last thing our officers really need to be doing is wasting their time busting the kid that was sitting on their couch smoking a joint versus the guy that's pushing heroin that just killed four people. You know, our time and our resources can be well better spent. And I'm sorry that it's actually disappointing that it has to take this many steps and go through this many processes on such a ridiculous subject. Again, we should be here talking about alcohol or prescription drugs. Let's outlaw those and, you know, let's see how the state can improve. Not to mention that you decriminalize marijuana and ultimately end prohibition. I hate to say it, but you're probably going to see a boost in tourism. You're probably going to see a spike in people visiting our state. So I hope that I was able to give some positive points. I don't want to waste any of your time because I'm sure you've been here for quite a while and you're going to be here for quite a while longer. But I really thank you all for taking the time to sit here and listen to us. And if there's any questions I can answer for you, I would be more than welcome to.
Thank you very much for your testimony this morning. Are there any questions? Seeing none, thank you very much. Okay, seeing the last person who has signed up to speak has spoken, we're going to close the public hearing on House Bill 640.
No.
The committee will be in recess just for 5 minutes.